Good morning, good evening, good night, wherever, however, and whenever you're listening. Welcome to another episode of The Melanin Report. I'm your host, Marquis Lupton, and say it with me, y'all. We got another dope show for you today. It is episode 50. I cannot believe it. I want to thank you, the listener, for tuning in and rocking out with your boy every week ever since September when we debuted this program. And I am so excited and I'm just so elated to be at this episode 50. This is the end of season one, and I mean, we had some great conversations, y'all. I mean, we talked about how cannabis affects laws against black people. We talked about the melanated bar, who looks to raise the bar with their melanated skincare and amassed $1 million. Amazing. We also talked about the tumultuous history of African Americans and Hollywood. And do you remember the DMV's media prince conversation that we had with him? Or how about the rise of the black woman entrepreneur? That was actually one of my favorite ones. One of my also favorite ones was speaking with a newsmaker, author, and musician Haywood Donerson. That was a good one. And the stigma of black men and mental health monologue and panel, that was good too. We cannot forget about the discussion on black sororities and black fraternities. That was a good one with the ladies of the Divine Nine. And the homie, Shelby Warmly, she came through talking to us about changing careers and taking that leap. I mean, we had so many great interviews. We had so many people bless us with their perspective on life, their perspective on their careers, and just giving us the game on what they feel as though works best for them to be successful, like a Joshua Leonard when he spoke about the lack of diversity in animation, and you can tell that he was very passionate about that. Or how about the conversation back in October that I had with John Mina, who looked to balance the scales of justice and him running for district judge in his district. I mean, we talked about collard greens. We had a conversation with the king. We had a conversation with the king, Prolific Hickman, about how he got started. We had a deep conversation talking about the prison to pipeline system, the school to prison pipeline system. And also one of the most heartfelt interviews with Ethan A. Poetic, where doctors gave him a 1% chance of living. And folks, this now is episode 50, where we will be doing a deep dive into the rich history of Dr. MLK. Now, we all heard the rumors and everything, and this episode of the Melanin Report, we peel back those rumors. Actually, we get rid of those rumors and get to the truth of who MLK was. One of them being that he actually wanted to retire from being a civil rights fighter and wanted to retire and teach at the University of Boston. So, I mean, we get into a whole lot of great details with Dr. Nathaniel Gadsden. I was honored to have him on the Melanin Report and give me this game on everything I knew existed, everything I didn't know existed, and everything I wanted to know about Dr. MLK Jr. Now, this is episode 50, and if you haven't checked out any of the other 49 episodes, then friend, I implore you to take some time out this month and catch up on everything Melanin Report. Again, this is episode 50, and I want to thank you, the listener, for joining me on this season one journey. Now, let's get to our discussion. First question here, what role did Martin Luther King Jr. play in the civil rights movement?
Well, you know, most people think of Dr. King as being the absolute leader of that movement. You know, they think of him having been not only the voice, but the person that most people were drawn to, especially in the early years. Dr. King, of course, entered into the movement when he was only 26 years old. He was thrust into the movement by way of, you know, proxy, so to speak, because he was the new kid in town. He was a prolific voice, of course, and he had a tremendous reasoning power. But remember, he was only 26 years old.
Yeah.
He was finishing up his doctorate degree at Boston University. And so there were ministers there who had been there for a long time in that particular area that he was, you know, in. And they were not burned out, but they were, you know, they were at odds as to which way to go. So to have a new voice in town, they found it easier to rally behind this young man who was brilliant, obviously, but also he was new. Okay. And he didn't have all that baggage and everything that some of the other ones carried. Also remember that Dr. King was following a gentleman who doesn't get enough credit in history. And I'm just drawing a blank on his name right now, and they actually did a movie about his life. This gentleman was a fiery preacher who was, you know, confronting, you know, the isms of the time, racism and everything else, and especially as it related to African-American people. He was extremely active as he was confrontational. So when the congregation hired Dr. King, they made it very clear to him they did not want him to be involved in the civil rights movement. They didn't want him to be out there as a voice. And so he was kind of going against the grain. So he actually had some opposition within his congregation about being elected to this newly formed thing called the student, you know, the SCLC, Southern Christian Leadership Conference. And so he took a gamble because, you know, again, he was relatively new. And then to call for a bus boycott and to be leading that along with, you know, the NAACP and, of course, Rosa Parks being at the center of that, there was a lot at stake, you know. So Dr. King stepped in with a particular philosophy of nonviolence. He believed that, you know, you had to confront evil. At the same time, you couldn't do evil for evil. So this new philosophy that he brought on board, and remember that a lot of people don't even know that Dr. King had six principles that led and guided him through his entire civil rights, you know, activism. And then he developed six steps, and he chronicled those things in his book called Stride Towards Freedom. And he had studied, you know, of course, he was a Christian pastor, so he already knew about love and nonviolence and all that. But then he began to put a framework to it based around his understanding what the civil rights movement of the South needed. And the South was a vicious place. You know, don't let people fool you. You know, it was a very vicious place for African-American people. If you stepped out of line, as we know from Emmett Till and so many other examples, the countless names of people who were murdered, Sverna Goodman and Cheney along the way, and so many others. So Dr. King knew fully what he was stepping into. He was no shrinking violet, but he was also surprised at the level of anger, you know, on and also, you know, where people were caught up in what to do. They were so afraid of what to do because they could lose jobs, they could lose their life. You know, these police officers, police force was stacked against them. The politicians were stacked against them. There was a lot going on. So again, most people in the early days of Dr. King's, you know, leadership saw him as the absolute leader. Why? Because he had the prolific voice. He was a fresh new voice. And then he created a movement. By the way, the boycott, you know, there against for the bus, you know, system lasted for over a year and what, about a year and a month or something like that. So it wasn't something that just happened very quickly. But it wasn't the only boycott that was happening around the country. So one of the things that we know about history is often told by those who tell it. History is understood by a particular perspective. So, you know, I've discovered in the last 20 years, in fact, a lot that was happening in this country that, you know, oftentimes we don't hear anything about. And there were people who were lifting up Dr. King's name, for example. I think it was Oklahoma City had the first big set-ins. But most people would think it was Greensboro, South Carolina, or North Carolina, one or two of those. But anyhow, no, those were the most famous because of the college students who were chronicled. But there were set-ins taking place all over the place. In fact, in Oklahoma City in 1958, there were people lifting up Dr. King's name. And only until recently did we hear about these set-ins that took place in Oklahoma City. So I say all that just to simply say it to your question. Dr. King was seen as, quote unquote, the leader, the voice. And one of the reasons that happened is because of the work of John H. Johnson, who had Ebony Magazine, And then there were others who stepped up. The black press was huge back then. And the black press began to be muted. So his name was lifted up constantly, being, you know, in the forefront of. But there were many people. We had a lot of lieutenants that worked with him, you know, Abernathy and Andrew Young and, you know, Jesse Jackson and so many others, you know, that too many to mention. Women as well, by the way. That's another thing about the movement. We often talk about it from a male perspective, but there were a lot of women who were also involved in the movement who were true leaders, you know, Daisy Bates and so many others that don't get mentioned enough in our history. So long answer to your question.
Oh, that's all right. And I'm actually glad that you brought up the black press, because that was going to be a part of my package of questions. So I'll just ask it right now. What role did the black press play in to spread the word of Dr. King and to really spread his message? Because, you know, there wasn't Twitter back then, you know, you weren't emailing people, you know, there weren't cell phones. So what role did this black press, did the black press play in the civil rights movement and spreading this message that Dr. King had?
Well, the black press, you know, again, was huge back then. Not as big as it should have been, but it was big. And then, you know, it worked. The paper that gets a lot of press, a lot of coverage around the civil rights movement was the Chicago Defender. And hats off to the Pullman car porters, mostly black porters who worked on the trains. They would get the papers and then they would distribute those papers as they went across country. They knew how to drop those papers off. And they had to kind of do it in a very secretive way. So, you know, a lot of whites just kind of turned their heads, people that were in charge, because they didn't think much of it. They didn't know what was really happening. But that was the way that a lot of information got spread through the black press because of the Chicago Defender. You had in New York, the New York Amsterdam News. In Philadelphia, you had the Philadelphia Tribune. You had the American, Afro-American out of Washington, D.C. But all throughout the country, there were all these newspapers who were able to tell the story. There's the National Newspapers Association, quite frankly, that still exists. And that is the national arm of the black newspapers in this country. I used to write a column for the black newspapers just by simply writing it and sending it out called Consider This. And I would always pick up my papers to see who picked it up and never worried about trying to get paid or anything. I just wanted my voice to be heard. And I remember one day here in Harrisburg, I went down to the store that I usually got my papers from and they weren't there. And I was like, oh, what happened? And the guy said, well, no one was buying them. I said, what do you mean no one was buying them? I'm buying them. He said, yeah, but you're probably the only one. So one of the things that happened was that as integration began to take place, we were really into integration. That was part of the movement around the civil rights movement, why we could not have access to everything that everyone else had, why we had to go in the back of the door and ride in the back of the bus and all that kind of stuff. So the overemphasis of integrating into society, you know, became both a good thing and problematic at the same time, which is really interesting. Because think about it, the black press was playing a critical role. But then as we begin to demand for more inclusion in the mainstream, some of our institutions begin to suffer and people saw them as lesser than. So back in the day, really a lot of the stories that were written and a lot of things that we talked about never appeared in the mainstream press, unless it was just some kind of little hiccup or byline here or there. But the black press was on it. They were really on it. And we had some outstanding photographers like Amante Sleep, who was a photographer for Ebony Magazine and many of the black newspapers. He was an award-winning photographer. Then you have writers. You know, just going down the line with some of those persons out of Philadelphia, even I got a chance to meet a few of them. You know, they were iconic people who were telling our story when no one else would. And they were telling the backstory. They weren't just telling the surface story. They actually did the research to tell the story. That's why it's so good right now. I think it's on Netflix. It could be on one of those other streaming stations, but they have a movie out about Bernard Rustin.
Yep, that's on Netflix. Rustin.
And did you see that? That was really well done.
Yes,
and,
indeed.
I'm sure that, you know, people fact check all that stuff. But it's, you know, there's a lot of good storytelling out there now that are being dramatized movie-wise and these stories that are telling us a lot about a history we didn't know, thanks to people like Ava DuVernay and, you know, Oprah Winfrey and others who are taking, you know, Tyler Perry has done some outstanding things, even outside of all of the comedy and stuff he does. He's, you know, all of them are storytellers. And so our real story still has just surfaced. We still have yet to be. I hope somebody one day comes out and talks about the power of the Black press, and also not its demise. It's gone down, and you know, but it's not dead. That's the good news about it. Mm-hmm. But still, if you pick up Black newspapers, you expect to see stories that you would not otherwise see in the mainstream.
Question here. Can you discuss Dr. King's involvement in the Selma to Montgomery marches?
You know, there was a major movement to address voter rights, you know, just human rights, that, if you will. And part of what happened is that oftentimes the story is told only from the perspective of Dr. King's involvement. Oftentimes, some of those marches took place when Dr. King was not able to march, quite frankly. Hmm. And so, you know, he was either jailed or, you know, he was in peril, or he was in some other part of the country. So a lot of movements took place, a lot of marches took place, but oftentimes, you know, of course, when he was there, the cameras were there, but oftentimes those marches were organized by some of his lieutenants. Hmm. And but they still had the same, you know, power, the same direction, purpose, you know, attached to it. There's a gentleman here in Harrisburg who was a great photographer, and I didn't know that he had such an expansive collection. And one day he showed me some pictures of Jesse Jackson and some others down in Florida leading a massive march. And then he was another place, and I'm like, wow. So quite frankly, a lot of what took place when Dr. King was marching for rights, especially for, you know, the right to vote. Because he understood that the right to vote had power. In other words, if we couldn't get elected officials in there who had that trickle-down power, they were the ones that, you know, elected or appointed the chief of police. Mm-hmm. Chief of police, of course, appointed and was able to hire people that, you know, would do his bidding, so to speak, back in the day. There's a gentleman here in Harrisburg who wrote a fantastic novel. And I said to myself, oh, man, this is really good. He said, well, a lot of this is based on my life. He said, this is how I grew up. And so he was telling the stories. Wow. Of how these police officers were just taking people out, man. I mean, taking them out, literally. And folks were in the town, that southern town they grew up in, was so afraid to speak up. So it wasn't any surprise to him that when they, you know, trudged the Tallahatchie River looking for Swerna Goodman and Cheney, they found all these other bodies. Mm. And it was like, where did these people come from? Well, they came from the community, came from the neighborhood. So Dr. King understood not only the importance for you know, the voter rights, mm-hmm. For people to have access to public transportation and public, you know, facilities, for people to be simply treated as human beings. That's what those marches are all about. So it was cloaked in, you know, voter rights, but it had a lot longer, bigger expanse than just that. Mm-hmm. And those persons who lived it understood it. And so that's what Dr. King, that's why he put it on the line. He also understood, though, that, you know, violence begets violence. So mm-hmm. he was so determined, you know, to help foster that movement called nonviolence. That's why you had the Highlander School for Nonviolent Social Change. And I hope I'm saying the title right, but Highlander was an organization where a lot of the great minds met, and it morphed into a civil rights, you know, bastion where people went. Dr. King himself went and taught there. And others went there to learn how to be nonviolent. And so the nonviolent movement wasn't just about people saying, we're not going to do this. They were actually trained to be nonviolent. Rosa Parks did not just sit down on that bus. There were many people sat down before Rosa Parks. Mm. And there was a young lady who I can't even think of her name right now, but I wrote an article about her. But anyhow, she had sat down before Rosa Parks did and was arrested and this and that. But they also said they tried to say that she was pregnant at the time. She's only 15. They tried to taint her and paint her in a, you know. So the question was, would the community get behind her with all these questions? So when Rosa Parks came along, who was the secretary of the local NAACP, who was extremely well known in the community and was very sophisticated, when she sat down, that was someone that was like not blemished, so they could get behind her. But she was well prepared to do what she did. She was not that tired. She was tired. She was sick and tired of injustice. That's what she was tired of. Mm. And so when she sat down with, you know, with the vision of a Dr. King and others in mind. She did that on purpose, and she did it for a reason. But I had a young man say to me in one of the schools, well, she just sat down. She didn't do anything. And he had seen the barbershop movie. That was, you know, he was one of these young kids who was impressed by that. I said, oh, no, she did a lot more than just that. I said, think about it. I said, what did they do to her? Such a thing you never hear about is what happened to Rosa Parks after she was, was arrested. I said, do you know what they did to people back in those jails and stuff? I said, no one talks about that or writes about that. By the way, do you know that she had to leave that city? Her husband lost her job, and she, of course, lost her job, and they were run out of it. They had to leave the South. She went to Detroit. And, so there were so many things were happening. So Dr. King was fully aware of all this. So that's why his tactics and what he was preaching was so very important, because he understood what was at stake. And it was about power, but it was also about equal rights and human rights. And, people just seeing us in a different light. In fact, us seeing ourselves in a different light. There are a lot of people who are convinced that we shouldn't speak up, speak out. Remember when Dr. King got stabbed, he was stabbed by an older black woman. And they called her deranged. She, you can say she was deranged, but she was so afraid that a Dr. King's message was just messing it up for the rest of us, so to speak. And so she said, are you, and I forget how she said it. She didn't say Martin Luther King. And after he says, yes, I am, she took that pen and stabbed you right in the chest. And then he had that famous speech, if I had but sneezed. And a young white girl heard the speech, and she wrote him a letter. And she was just a young little kid in school. And she said, I'm so glad you didn't sneeze. And he recited that in one of his sermons. But that was what he was facing. It wasn't just, the white racism was very, but there were a lot of black folks who were afraid, and they were so afraid that they were, they were angry with these leaders speaking out. And that's why I say the pastor before Dr. King, whose church he took over, that brother was, seen as someone powerful, but also someone who was feared because he thought he was messing it up for everybody. So when Dr. King stepped into that leadership role, started talking about civil rights and equal rights and voting rights. Remember, a lot of people think also Dr. King was shot and killed literally 1 year after he made the speech in New York City at the Riverside, I think it was Riverside Baptist Church, I believe it was, and he spoke out against the war. Even his lieutenant said to him, do not do that. And some people even used the phrase, stay in your lane. Dr. King, now wait a minute, you're a black civil rights leader. What you doing speaking out on this war? That's going against America. And they said that they think that a year later. By the way, one of the books you have to read is Death of a King by Tavis Smiley. And Death of the King by Tavis Smiley is one of the finest pieces I've read on Dr. King's life that wasn't just chronicling the history. It actually gave the emotion. And it talks about how the last year of Dr. King's life, he was literally depressed. He could not find peace anywhere. He was a depressed, probably clinically so. And a lot of people don't realize that about him, that he was separated from his family a lot of times. He was concerned about, them being attacked, whatever, because his house had been bombed and everything else. And he was very depressed. And no matter where he went, he actually took refuge in the island where Adam Clayton Powell was. And Powell just went after him. It's like, what are you doing with this nonviolent stuff? And you're ruining it. And he couldn't find any peace there. And then everywhere he went, people telling him what to do and how to do it. And so, it was a tough spot.
So one thing that I do want to highlight here is something that's really hasn't traditionally been talked about was King's philosophy shift near the end of his life with such things as like the Poor People's Campaign. Can you tell our audience about the Poor People's Campaign and this shift that King experienced and the reason why?
Well, he was never, ever detached from the people. He always understood. I mean, Dr. King was someone that rolled up his sleeves, going to a pool hall and shoot pool. He went onto the college campuses. He was always up to date as to what people were thinking, this and that. He just simply had a philosophy and steps, by the way, connected to his philosophy that said, but this is how we can get there. As the more militant voices, began to raise with Stokely Carmichael and SNCC, you had the Black Panthers and others. He understood those brothers and sisters. Remember, there was Malcolm. There was this famous picture of him and Malcolm meeting. They were at polar opposites at that time. Malcolm was extremely, anti our government and everything else was going on. And he felt like by any means necessary. The biggest shift came from Malcolm X, quite frankly, in terms of his philosophy of things. A lot of people tend to forget that Malcolm, after going to Mecca, actually became closer to King's philosophy than King did to his. And so what Dr. King understood was that you had to demonstrate, you had to take it to the people, So the Poor People's Campaign, he was talking about poor people. He wasn't just talking about, just African-American people in our plight. He understood that. He also understood that poverty was one of the great the three great evils of our time. And so the try to organize the poor people's campaign was to say that to the world, especially to the United States of America, you know, poverty is a problem. Poverty is a problem for everybody, you know, and especially for, you know, people of color. So a lot of times when people say he shifted, well, he was never, you know, so timid or anything like that. In fact, he said in his principles, you know, to be nonviolent is to be courageous. You know, you want to talk about how tough you are, be nonviolent, okay? And let people come at you and spit at you and this and that, you know. So he never, he didn't shift as far as people think he did. Anyone who probably got a chance to sit down and talk to him understood that he understood what it meant to fight. He simply thought that fighting was going directly to a person and confronting them with the truth. So one of the real stories they talk about is how he went to the White House and confronted Lyndon Baines Johnson. And Johnson, of course, you know, helped to usher in the Civil Rights Bill of 1964, I think it is, and all that. But Johnson hated King, or they say, some people paint it that way. I can't say that to be, you know, true, but they said he would not really speak to King. King was always direct. King was always business-minded. So what Johnson did was he talked directly to Jose Williams. Jose Williams was also from the South, but he wore the bib overalls and this, and he knew how to schmooze and talk to the, you know, to white power people, whereas King was like, no, excuse me, I have a PhD. I went to Boston University. I know how to talk to you too. And we ain't talking all that jive. We getting down to business up in here. So he was not well liked because he was so focused and so business and a powerful speaker. You know, one of the things that I remember, there was a brilliant playwright who, young lady, young African-American female, who did a piece, and I think it was called Mountaintop, and Angela Bassett played the role. And I remember being in New York watching this here, and it talked about what may have happened in that room that night before he was assassinated, before he had to make that speech. Remember, Dr. King was, he was not feeling well the whole bit, but he said, I gotta go, because they wanted him, you know, they were down in the Memphis, Tennessee, and there was just so much going on. And he said to them, he said, listen, he said, we have some difficult days ahead. He said, but that really doesn't matter to me now, because I've been to the mountaintop and I've seen the promised land. And he said, also, I may not get there with you, but we as a people will get. He had a determination and a foresight, I think, at that moment that we were all in danger, but we had to speak out. And I'm going to say it again, that last year of his life, he was greatly depressed. He was depressed by so many things that were going on. He was being pushed and pulled and told that, you know, your movement is wrong. By the way, they took a poll of African-American people right before he was shot and killed, and his popularity was in the toilet.
Really?
A lot of people who are praising King now, back in the day, they thought he was out of touch. They thought he was on the wrong side. They were listening to the more militant voices. I was 1969, I graduated from high school. And so I was just turning about 18. I was 18 when I graduated, so I was going to turn 19. My point being, I was on my way to college. You know, I was fully aware. And there was a question asked, which way Black American? Dr. King stood fast. And listen, we want to integrate, we want to just win that at the same time. This is how we must do it. Other people said, no, why we can't wait. Even he wrote a book that said, why we can't wait. So he was not so impatient that he was willing to give up his stance. And so he said, listen, by the way, we're all in this together. Let me make one of the different real quick here turn. You know, they shot and killed Fred Hampton.
Yes.
Fred Hampton was only 21 years old.
Yes.
And by the way, I had never heard a speech from Fred Hampton. I always heard about Fred Hampton. And then more recently, I've been, you know, privileged to hear some of his speeches and everything. What a brilliant guy he was. And he was doing exactly where Dr. King was on his way to. Dr. King had already been there. I take that back. He was trying to bring everybody together.
Yes.
But what made Fred so dangerous is that he was actually doing it by bringing some of those more militant, you know, whites who saw themselves as being almost like the skinhead of their time and saying, hey, we're all just together. Why? Because of that poor people thing, because of the way the system's treating all of us. You know, they're calling us the N-word, but maybe you're the N-word too. And next thing you know, he was gathering up a coalition. So when they burst into that room at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning and shot and killed Fred Hampton, they knew exactly what they were doing. And that's the reason why they had to kill King, for the same reason. He had become a unifier. He began to make people understand, wait a minute, this isn't just about color. Because that was the bill of goods we were sold. So to have a poor people's campaign, not a poor Black people's, not a poor, you know, people of color's campaign, he said a poor people's campaign. And it was led by Black people, but it was bringing everybody up under that tent. And it was going to demonstrate it in D.C. so that everybody could see it, be, you know, put the big spotlight on it. Oh, this man got to go. And so that's exactly what happened. A lot of people still feel today that James Earl Ray did not operate alone. There's no way he could have, and this and that. And where were the police? And, you know, the whole thing was just set up in such a way. They say the same thing about Malcolm X.
Mm-hmm.
So did Dr. King move, you know, away from, or did he change? I always question that. I say he was who he was.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that he was a fighter, but he fought his own way. A lot of people that never did what he did because they didn't have the guts to do it. I mean, to actually confront your enemy, actually, he didn't call Bo Connor names. You listen to our so-called politicians today, even the former president, they're used to calling people names and making fun of folks and saying, okay, you never heard King do that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
King talked about the issues, and he talked about racism, and he talked about things that we all could relate to, but he didn't just get on and say, Bo Connor, Jura, whatever, whatever. He knew who Bo Connor was. But he confronted them. How many people go and stand and then mobilize people? By the way, King was greatly depressed also when the young people stood up. So there's a wonderful video that you can get called the Children's March.
Mm-hmm.
And I highly recommend that you get it. You get it through what's the name of the organization. And if you have an organization, they'll give it to you for free. But anyhow, look at the Children's March, which is a great documentary. Dr. King was jailed. And he literally said to, you know, James Bevel and these other leaders, don't do that. Don't use those kids. But those kids went out there. And if it had not been for those kids, you know, a lot of the folks and a lot of the movement would have just simply died. Because a lot of the people were so afraid of losing their jobs and stuff. King understood that. So King spoke to the great issues of the time, from, you know, militarism, that he thought was a major problem, to poverty, and also, you know, to racism. He thought those were the three big monsters that we were all facing. And it affected all of us, you know, the persons who were perpetrating that stuff, as well as the persons who were being the victims of it, quote unquote. We were all victims of it, he said. So, you know, that was the brilliance of Dr. King. He marched for everybody, even though he went directly to the African-American community. If you look at the March in Washington, you will see there were a lot of white folks who were there with signs and marching, a lot. You know, were most of us African-American? Absolutely. But there were a whole bunch of white folks, a whole bunch of Asians, a whole bunch of, you know, Hispanics who showed up and who understood this was about the universal us and not just one segment. So that was the beauty and the brilliance of Dr. King. So why he pushed so hard for that is because he understood poverty affects everybody.
And with this poverty message, why do you think that it's now becoming talked about more with his legacy versus in past decades? We're seeing now documentaries. We're seeing more discussion pieces on the Poor People's Campaign. Whereas, like when I was growing up, you know, I didn't hear about the Poor People's Campaign until I was a grad student at Morgan State. But I could tell you the ABCs of MLK growing up. So why do you feel as though that this Poor People's Campaign is now getting the deserved highlights it deserves?
Well, you have more people telling the story. Mm-hmm. So you have more people of color telling the story. You know, they say there's a difference between the lion who tells the story and the hunter who tells the story.
Mm-hmm.
So the hunter has a perspective, and the hunter's telling you what happened, but from his perspective or her perspective. And the lion's saying, wait a minute. I was the prey. Let me tell you what I saw. And so part of what was happening was back in the day, we had the black press, as we talked about before, that was kind of being muted. You had a lot of other voices coming out. And the question was, what were those voices? Let me just give you a quick example.
Mm-hmm.
BET. BET was founded by an African-American gentleman, you know, Robert Johnson. And he had a perspective in mind to do something that would speak to. But he quickly found out that a lot of what he hoped would sell wasn't being supported.
Mm-hmm.
So in order for him to get advertisements and stuff like that, he ended up with a whole bunch of videos and the rise of hip hop and all that.
Mm-hmm.
On one hand, it's a good thing. We're celebrating 50 years of hip hop. There's a lot of good that came out of that, you know, but also there's a lot of stuff. By the way, we didn't know about the Poor People's Campaign, so many other things. Why? Because we were too busy on this other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And that was what I called the diversion.
Okay.
So it's not that we weren't still telling the story. The question was, who was telling the story and why? And what was not being told? We have a gentleman by the name of Takashi Buford from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. He's, you know, his parents were African-American and Japanese. His mother was Japanese. Takashi's an attorney. Takashi, you know, moved down to D.C. and then he had this epiphany and this idea. And he went to tell some hard-hitting documentary stories about our history. And no one in Hollywood was, you know, was touching him. But all of a sudden, he come up with this idea called Set It Off. And this was something he just kind of played with. Gosh, he's a brilliant guy. But guess what sold in Hollywood?
Set It Off.
So, cool. Then he wrote, Booty Call and House Party 3. Gosh, he's much bigger than that. Now, no put down on any of that, but that wasn't telling you about the Poor People's Campaign, which he desired to talk about. But if you can't get the backing, and Hollywood's constantly pushing that kind of stuff away, or whoever, you know, obviously Hollywood is the general. Well, that's the same kind of thing was happening back in the day when you were coming along, as opposed to, I was keenly aware of, the Poor People's Campaign and everything, but I was an avid reader of Ebony Magazine and the Black Press. Even Jet, you know, would tell you stuff that was going on. All of that stuff began to come down. And how many times, when was the last time you seen Ebony Magazine? They're not even printing it right now. When's the last time you picked up a Black newspaper, unless you're in a city that has one? It's just, And so there was so much commercialization of and telling of our story from a particular lens, you know, the music and the hip hop and all that, poetry began to rise. And then next thing you know, the Black poet like myself, our voices became sort of like, that's just the same old story. People kind of got tired of it. They didn't want to hear it, you know, through our medium. So there's a lot that happens, man. A lot of times it's our fault in the sense that we need to be more militant and more, more determined and persistent to tell our story the way it should be told, and not just give up and go in that direction that's the most popular to make that money. And so one of the stories about Dr. King also is that when he died, he was not a rich man at all. He won the Nobel Prize, which gave him money. He could go speak anywhere and make speeches and make money. Dr. King almost gave everything away. In fact, one of his biggest, if not his biggest benefactor, was Aretha Franklin. Aretha Franklin gave more money to the civil rights movement than anybody, from what I was told. And if you watch her funeral, which was a brilliant, long funeral until it got to the preacher, I'll leave that alone. But anyhow, really, she gave monies like crazy to the funeral and constantly asked Dr. King, what is it that you need? And if it wasn't for her, you know, he would not have been able to travel the way he traveled and do some of the things that they were able to do. So, that's often to Aretha Franklin.
Wow, I was today years old, and our guest today is Mr. Nathaniel Gadsden, again, giving us all this good information on the things we knew, the things we didn't know, and the things we did not know existed about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. You and your wife, you have a unique connection and involvement with the Dr. King and his family, correct?
You know, it's interesting. Yeah, I'm a graduate of Westchester State College back in the day. And I will tell you that I had a unique opportunity to introduce Coretta Scott King when she came to our campus. And our Black history professor at that time was Dr. Barbara Black. And so she said to me one day, she said, you know, we're bringing Coretta Scott King to campus. Oh, wonderful. And she asked me if I'd do the honors of introducing her. And I said, sure. And then she revealed to me that Dr., I think her name was Barbara Ferris, happened to be Martin Luther King's sister. And Martin Luther King's sister taught at Cheney State College back in the day. And then she just recently passed this year, I believe. But anyhow, Dr. Ferris was only about 3 miles, Cheney's only 3 miles away from Westchester. And so she would come up and visit with her sister-in-law quite a bit, but you didn't know. So we're at a basketball game. Westchester's playing Cheney. And Cheney's an all-African-American school, if people don't know, one of the oldest, if not the oldest, African-American school in the country. And so all of a sudden, the doors open, and in walks the King family, totally unannounced.
Wow.
She had come up to see her, and that's when her kids were just little small kids. And they come in, and Coretta Scott King literally sat directly behind me. And we're sitting on bleachers now. The whole gym, the game stops. Everybody stands. Everybody's applauding. It's like, and it is. It was just quite shocking. It's like the King family, you know, my first time seeing them in person. And they come up and they sit down behind us.
Wow.
And her knees are literally touching my back. If I lean back, and so everyone's, trying to, and people want her autograph, hope, and she's, oh, no, come on, we're here to watch the game. And again, her kids are small. So that was my first encounter. And then I end up, having an opportunity to introduce her. I went to Atlanta for the first time. And I was at a conference, and me and this guy hooked up, and we just started talking about history and everything. I said, man, look, I'm going over to the church, man, Sunday, So he said, man, I'll go with you. So we rented a car, literally, jumped up and go over to, and so one of the other things about this whole trip is that it was maybe a month before, or 2 months before, Martin Luther King's mother was shot and killed in the church. I don't know if a lot of people remember that. She was the organ player for Ebenezer Baptist Church. And this a white guy comes in, and he's sitting amongst the audience like everybody else. And all of a sudden, he stands up and just starts shooting.
Wow.
And one of the bullets hit Martin Luther King's mother in the head. And she died right there in Sunday service. That's a story that most people never even hear about.
Yeah.
But anyhow, so we go down maybe a month or 2 months later. And I remember there were two guys distinctly standing at the front, door there. And a lot of people were coming in from all over the world, really, because anybody visiting there, you know, they want to go to the church. And so we go in, and the place is packed. And the gentleman says to me, he says, listen, you guys are going to have to go downstairs. There's no room in the sanctuary, but they do have TV monitors downstairs. And I said, okay, dang it. But as I turn, and the big old car pulls up, you know, and who's stepping out of the car but Coretta Scott King.
Mm.
And so I said to my buddy, I said, that's Coretta Scott King. So we stood there. And so as she begins to come up the steps, she literally stops. And she sees us standing there at the door, you know, standing back, like, you know, near the sanctuary. But she kind of stops because they've already had a shooting there and everything. So the two gentlemen turned around. They looked like deacons, but both of them pulled their coats back. And they had badges and guns. And they said, gentlemen, do we have a problem? And I said, no. I said, Mrs. King, Dr. Barbara Black from Westchester told me to tell you hello if I see you. She said, Barbara Black? I said, yeah. I said, Doctor. She said, how do you know Dr. Barbara Black? I said, she's my professor, you know. So anyhow, to make a long story short, she comes in, takes me by the arm, takes another gentleman by the arm, and she says, so where are you boys from? And she talks to us. She goes downstairs with us. Down there, they already have her space up front, of course, and she's Coretta Scott King. She goes downstairs with us, sits in the basement with us, and talks to us for anywhere from 15 minutes to half an hour, just talking about everything. And then she thanks us for coming and this and that, and then she goes upstairs.
Wow.
I've been washing my arm for 40 years. I was walking around like this. Yeah, yes. It was an incredible time. And then, of course, you know, there were other times. But my wife and I both also, in the 90s, we went through what's called the Martin Luther King Leadership Institute.
Mm.
And so we had it here in Harrisburg. We took a group of young people and immersed them into, you know, that. First, we were trained ourselves, and then we worked with them. And we went down to Millersville University and different places, taking these kids around. And the idea was to bring Black, white, Hispanic kids, everybody together, and teach them about the King's principles.
Mm.
And so we did that. And then my wife and I were able to go down to D.C. We're both trainers. And we went down to D.C. and we were part of the National Martin Luther King Leadership Institute, whatever. We were presenters at that conference, and the King family was there. Fast forward, probably about maybe 10 years ago, my wife got a chance to meet the oldest daughter first, who has since died now.
Mm.
Oh, boy. But anyhow, Bernice King, who was just here in Harrisburg, at one of the colleges close by. Anyhow, my wife created the Coretta Scott King dinner. I'm just going to call it this. She has a magazine. My wife had a magazine for a long time. And on the front cover of the magazine was, Coretta Scott King. And then we had this big dinner down at Hershey, Motor Lodge, and it was huge. And the main speaker was Bernice King, Dr. Bernice King. So she brought her in, and we got a chance to interface with her and all that kind of good stuff. So anyhow, we've had a lot of involvement with the King family over the years in different ways. And both of us are, like I said, graduates of the Martin Luther King Leadership Institute, and now I'm on the board of directors. In fact, we're just starting on June the 19th will be our first class of our new cohort. And we usually graduate anywhere between 20 to 25 people. And I'm talking about college presidents, police officers, teachers, housewives, just anybody that is really, really interested in being a part of this institute and to learn how to be a more effective leader using King's principles. That's what we do. I'm always the opening speaker, one of the opening speakers, and I teach the six steps and six principles of Dr. Martin Luther King at our first session for all of those.
So then in 2024, where do you believe Dr. King's legacy stands?
Well, you know, I believe we're having a resurgence. I believe more and more people are understanding, the power of Dr. King's words, his actions, what he stood for the whole bit. We've seen enough violence now to understand maybe he's right, there's still some people who are going to always, be out there pushing a more aggressive, violent kind of a stance. But Dr. King was, he was literally there for everybody. He understood the context, excuse me, of racism and why racism was so pervasive and It was really about power and how they tried to just, you know, make us into inanimate objects, if not animals and all that kind of stuff. But he also tried to prove them wrong by his scholarship, the way he carried himself, by his confrontational skills. He had direct confrontation, but also by his ability to try to understand all sides. Mm. You know, he tried to understand the racists and tried to understand. In fact, that was one of the things he demanded in his principles and steps, is to sit down, listen, know what their argument is, know what they're trying to say. And also understand they come from context. So, for example, we have a number of people now who used to be skinheads or Klansmen or whatever, who have now seen the error of their ways, and they're going all over the country preaching against this stuff, telling you the inside story, how they were indoctrinated and this and that. That's all Dr. King was really asking for, was, you know, for people to listen, to be rational. You know, why always throw a Molotov cocktail or this guy? Yeah, they are beating us and they are killing us, and we got to expose them. And we got to, you know, do what the Black Lives Matter has done so well on one hand, but then they did not do the organizing part, my words, on the other hand. So, for example, back in the day, I knew that I could go to an NAACP meeting and see power there. You know, people always want to, I was one of those people as a young person. I didn't know anything about NAACP, so I just thought they weren't doing nothing. Oh, they ain't that, you know, and I would get up and make a speech in a minute about something. Didn't know what I was talking about. Dr. King said, know what you're talking about, okay? Do your research. Make sure that you have, you know, before you get up and jump on that platform that all of us want to do, you know, we jump on that platform, but we have to do our research. So when I really understood the power and the reach and the impact of a SCLC, you know, Urban League, NAACP, all that kind of stuff, I was embarrassed because I had no idea the power and the fight and everything else that was involved in this and what they were able to accomplish. It's not always the person out there with the big bullhorn and running their mouths about everything. Sometimes that's the last thing you need to do. But anyhow, he was very patient. He was very kind, but he also understood the danger of it all. And that's why he was so depressed, because so many people did not understand, and they were calling you names and saying all kinds of stuff, and they just stopped listening, and it became so emotional. When Dr. King was shot and killed back in April the 4th, 1968, I was living on Fifth Street here in Harrisburg. And I'll never forget hearing glass break immediately. I just come from, I was a track man and basketball and all that stuff. And I just come from the high school, and my brother hollered, hey, did you hear the news? He's upstairs. And he said, oh, did you hear? I said, what? He said, Dr. King was shot. I said, you gotta be, what? And then we're all running to the TVs trying to, you know. And so before I knew it, they announced that Dr. King had died. You know, Walter Cronk, no, it wasn't him. But anyhow, someone announced it, and I'll never forget just the silence. And then all of a sudden, you just hear glass breaking. And all up and down our street, I'm not going to call this one guy's name. He's a good dude. But I just remember him throwing bricks through people's windows and calling out white people and all that kind of stuff. And everybody was like, no, no, that's not the way. And of course, you know, there was a lot of rioting that took place all over the country. A lot of anger, a lot of stuff. And then people began to question, well, wait a minute. Now, Dr. King stood for something totally different than this. Why are we doing this? And a lot of cities got burnt down, gave... you know, just, and I just remember watching a game show as a young person, and all of a sudden they stopped the game show and started talking about what was happening in the country. And it's like, what, you know, and the folks talking as if we were just animals and running amok, and, you know, the, but then Dr. King's words began to be, you know, everybody started quoting him and talking about, you know, and then that letter from a Birmingham jail became more, people began to read that more. It's like, what was he saying to the clergy? Because where does the church really stand on all this? And, you know, there are a lot of clergymen, a lot of people who just simply were afraid to confront the system. And that whole movie, that I forget the name of it, but anyhow, the guy said, you can't handle the truth. When I heard years later, I remember thinking, yeah, go ahead, King. That was literally in his spirit, because he wanted people to handle the truth. Poverty, there was a lot of truth about poverty that we were not willing to face. Why? Because we live in a country where, you know, I mean, the wealth is just immense, but who has the wealth? And why don't more of that trickle down? Remember that trickle down theory stuff? So he was confronting all of that stuff. He said very famously that the most segregated hour in all of America was 11 o'clock on a Sunday morning, because that's when most of the churches were separated. So he said things, most with other people, of course, that just made you think. And that's what he wanted us to do, was to think and to confront the evil that lived within us and among us, and stop the nonsense of using, you know, very cliche kind of, you know, talk to justify something that's just not justifiable. The poverty in this country was not justifiable. The way the military was being used to go and destabilize other countries and stuff like that, and to move into Vietnam. He spoke out against Vietnam. Why are we doing this? What, you know, what was that all about? Well, they said it was the spread of communism and all that stuff. But then they said we lost the war. Well, wait a minute, did communism spread? What happened here? There's just a whole bunch of stuff that, you know, we were accepting, you know, as quote unquote, the one book said, the ugly American, and not doing anything about it. And then to have that, you know, that Tallahatchie, you know, river, come on, and to have all those bodies pulled up. Yeah, you know, of course, he's a human being. He's not walking around insensitive to that kind of stuff. He knew what that was all about. He lived it. And so many of us in the North who jumped on buses and came down, I'll never forget watching the one documentary where there were a lot of African-Americans who were angry with the whites who came down as they were all on the bus together. But he said some of them were so cavalier and this and that. And he said, and this one white girl, I'm just quoting this one African-American guy who saw himself as a freedom rider, you know, but he was so upset with this one white girl. She was just talking with him. He said, but then at the end of the day, he looked up. She was the one knocking on the doors. She was the one who was going into the homes and sitting down with these, you know, illiterate African-American people who were afraid to vote, who didn't know that they could. And she was the one who put herself in harm's way in proximity. He said, wait a minute. And he had a whole new respect. And I'm just, you know, quote this from a book that I read of how, you know, we got to stop judging each other so harshly. He said, it's one thing to talk about, it's another thing to do it. He said, when I looked at this young white girl who was college educated, who had never done anything like this in life, but she put herself in harm's way and she understood the danger, so she protected herself. But at the same time, she went unafraid and she did what she had to do. He said, I haven't judged her and looked at her. Well, that was King's point. Let's stop judging each other. And by the way, let's confront each other and let's tell the truth. And I can't understand your truth if I've never talked to you. If I've never heard you tell me what your truth is. So Dr. King was all about telling the truth and confronting and about business. He liked to laugh. They said he was a great joke teller. He liked to laugh and this and that. He said, but when it came down to business, he was about business. And a lot of these guys went to shucking job and all that kind of stuff. He said, why? You know why? So, you know, part of what they teach you in the Leadership Development Institute is to be a leader. And to be a leader is to know, first off, what the issues are. So you have to be educated. To have courage, that's another thing we talk about. And then also to not have motive. Very quickly, I know I'm kind of rambling here, but I remember sitting with a group of people that I truly admire. And we had lost their voice, not to say it that way, because I don't want to, you know, anybody that knows what I'm talking about, you know. But, and the voice was a major media outlet. Let's put it that way. And so we went, you know, to say, hey, listen, you know, a large segment of our community, the African-American community in particular, we've lost a major voice here. And now they've changed the format on us and this and that. And the question became amongst all of us, where's the ownership? Why don't we own these things? You know, what's going on here? Another thing is, how do we approach this? What do we do? What we did not know, and this happens way too often, is that a few amongst us had ulterior motives. So if I go in, and I have the motive of wanting to get this for myself, or how can I make money off of this, then that has nothing to do with freedom and, and, you know, being equal for everybody. And that's what you find sometimes. You find that people are easily bought off. And so there are people who say, here's what I'll do. And they make these little side deals and all that kind of stuff. We watched it. And, man, I could go on and on and on about that. So Dr. King was opposed to that kind of thinking. He wanted people to have a Christian, you know, he was a Christian minister, of course. So he wanted them to have a moral compass. He wanted them to be serious about the issues for everybody. He could have went out there and made tons of money just making speeches. One of the great stories from the civil rights movement is how Julian Bond lost to, you know, John Lewis, because John Lewis didn't want to do it. But John Lewis stood up one day during one of their great debates, so to speak. And he said, I'm going to show you some pictures. John Lewis had walked across the Edmund Pettus Bridge and got beat in the head. John Lewis had put himself in many different ways. He said, show us your pictures, Julian. Show us when you were on the front lines, Julian. Julian, you grew up with on the college campus. You grew up with your father being this and that. He said, you're very articulate. He said, but show me where you were on the front lines of the movement. I can show you King what King was. King was always in a suit. And King had on his, you know, his shirt at times and his khaki overalls. But that was very rare. When you saw King, he tried to be, hey, you know. But at the same time, he was on those front lines, you know, marching. He said, Julian, show me your pictures. And the audience caught it immediately. It's not that Julian wasn't a very articulate fighter for civil rights, but there's a certain way you fight, you know, and you can't fight if you're not willing to get out there and actually confront. And King was confront. Peaceful, I'll just call it a peaceful confrontation. The other thing was King always knew the direction he was trying to go in. The end of the day for King was the establishment of the beloved community. So he did not want just equality for that person. That he wanted equality for all people. And he was trying to establish the beloved community. So I can't do that if I'm willing to stand up and tear you down and call you all kinds of names and all that kind of stuff. You know, no, I can't do that because I'm not representing the God that I profess that I know. And that's what King always stood on. So he was trying to take the church to the people and the people to the church. And once he understood that and was willing to fight on that plane with that kind of understand, that kind of power, he could not be deterred. So he got depressed because so many people were turning against him and all that kind of stuff. And he, of course, he wanted to be with his family. Of course, he wanted to, you know, but at the same time, he had a big fight, man. God had put something on him. It was, you know, to whom much is given, much is, you know, much is required. And King had a voice that gave him a platform. When he spoke, people listened.
Yeah.
And he was a brilliant orator. So he's had this burden of being, quote unquote, the leader. And he was. People saw him as the leader. But then people wanted to get, you know, people build you up and then tear you down.
Yeah.
And he learned that very quickly. And then, you know, from 26 to 39, he and Malcolm X both were assassinated at the age of 39. You know, again, I go back to Fred Hampton, age of 21. You can go on down the line. So many voices are being silenced. And King had the opportunity to simply say, you know what, this ain't worth it. I'm gonna be over here with my family. I'm gonna go teach on the college campus somewhere. But he somehow he had that calling with him that just would not allow him to do that. And so, God bless him.
Mr. Gadsden, I want to thank you for coming on the Spark and giving all of this information on Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I mean, again, you gave us stuff that we didn't know existed. You gave us stuff that we wanted, and you gave us stuff that we needed. So, again, I want to thank you for joining us.
Brother Marquis, thank you so much, man. Hey, listen, you have a great spirit, man. It's my first time really meeting you and stuff, but I hope you keep on doing what you're doing. We need you, man. Thanks so much.
Yes, sir. Will do. Well, that concludes episode 50, and that concludes season one of The Melanin Report. I want to thank you for tuning in again and rocking out with me over these last couple of months as I gave you the things you needed, gave you the things you wanted, and gave you the things that you did not know existed. This has been one heck of a exciting ride. I want to thank Dr. Kamika Campbell for giving us the Mondays that we did not deserve from her. So want to thank her. She definitely helped enrich this program. I want to give a special shout out to our VP here at WYTF, Fred Vingen, who gave me the opportunity to give you all the Melanin Report. And without his thumbs up or thumbs down, this thing does not happen without that thumbs up. So I want to give a special shout out to Fred for giving me this opportunity. And then I want to give a shout out to you, the listener, for tuning in and rocking out with your boy for these past couple months. Like I said, this has been both insightful and delightful, and I'm looking forward to season two. Season two, we're going to get more melanated and more reported and more thee. So until we cross those burning sands into season two, enjoy season one, re-listen to episodes, share with a friend, and make sure that you do not the Melanin Report alone. For the last time, I am Marquis Lupton. This is the Melanin Report. Trust your dopeness, and I'll see you in season two. Now enjoy these sounds from our local artists.
Bear witness to the greatest rap you ever knew. I been cooking Chef Paulie with the damn spoon, whipping up a flow that's gonna hit you like a monsoon. They came for the rain, but the thunder made them gone soon. I'm playing the game, but my character's the wrong dude. I'm about to level up, put the bass in treble up. It's about to be a movie, you already know what's up. What is the cost? I'm planning on buying it all. It really don't matter the cost, I'm killing them all. I'm living a feeling that's really gonna put me ahead of them all. I'm killing them all, I said it, I meant it, the minute I did it, I went and repented, I'm praying to get it. I'm hoping you feel it, I'm really been feeling the sky is the limit. And I've been thinking about a plan to get the glory with a little bit of passion and a whole lot of balls. I've been on my grind like 24-9. If you look up at the sky, I say I'm just trying to ball. They can't stop the realest back. This is that motion picture action pack. I done came and went through hell and back. And I done learned some things, and now we're back. I can't stop, now I can't quit. Yeah, I can't stop, now I can't quit.
With you. Mixing and matching ingredients with obedience, tedious complications when making this rap tongue twister. I think I'm done with ya. Not psych, I lied. Digging up this grave as we speak, the time's arrived. Sing Amazing Grace, make peace, it's time to die. As the chorus sings in the back, Lord, let it shine. So meet Jamaica and pray you don't see me later. I'm not an instigator, but I will incinerate ya. Smoke till I see the vapor, vaporize the evidence. It's evident my punchlines pulverize before I break ya. Hold up, I'm feeling very sounds as evasive. All these haters shooting these hater lasers, I evade it. And I like my food cooked kinda Cajun by a pretty looking Asian with a body of persuasion. Cause I'm thinking about the next bitch.